celebrating 10 years of award-winning Car Talk. It's the In Wheel Time Car Show, your weekly go-to all things automotive place. Just ahead, we talk about America's deadliest roads, and we're going to go to England to get the skinny on all of that. We'll have This Week in Auto History, get you updated on the stories making automotive news headlines. Howdy, along with Mike, out of this world Mars. King Conrad DeLong, we need more Jeff Zekin. I'm Don Armstrong, glad that you could join us today. Thank you so much. Let's just get right over to jolly old England, shall we? And talk to Mr. Ben Williams. He is with a company called Teletrac Navman. And Ben, thanks so much for joining us. We really appreciate it. How are things over there in Great Britain today? Is the weather good?
You know what? It may come as a surprise, but actually it's been a beautiful sunny day. So no complaints from over here. So we're just sailing into a nice evening. So yeah, great over here. And I'm glad to be on with everybody. And thanks for having me on to talk with you about this this content.
Yeah, absolutely. So it's 4:30 in the afternoon, in case you're wondering over there. Mm-hmm. So we appreciate it. There is just a slight time change. But so, Ben, first of all, before we get into this, tell us a little bit about Teletrac Navman, maybe a 60-second synopsis of what Teletrac Navman does.
Yeah, for sure. So Teletrac Navman are basically, we're a data company. We focus on gathering data and information from vehicles and different assets that are used out in the field. And we gather that data, pull it back into software to enable businesses to get visibility of the vehicles themselves, to see how they're being used, how they're being driven, and to really, really drive safety initiatives and productivity initiatives within their organization. And we're really, really focused on helping and understanding and helping businesses understand how can they make and help their drivers be safer, to create a much safer environment out there for everyone on the road.
So are most of your clients like 18-wheeler companies and that sort of thing?
A high proportion are, but there is a mix. So right through the 18-wheelers down to your service fleets, who are maintenance engineers, your plumbers, electrical contractors. There's a wide range. We really specialize in 18-wheeler fleets, especially when there's hours of service compliance and regulations. But we offer platforms and solutions for a whole wide spectrum of vehicle types.
Over there, they call them lorries.
Lorries, that's right. So a question for you. So how did you come up with America's deadliest roads?
Well, it's something we've done previously. We did a study 4 years ago, which was really well received in the US, and we thought we wanted to do this on a consistent basis. And the main thinking behind it is we're really focused on road safety, and our software and our technology is all designed to help businesses become safer. And one of the main reasons we do this type of data analysis and study is to help raise the awareness of safety and safety initiatives, and you know, have conversations like we are today about road safety, and to bring it back to the fore to help everyone start to think about it. And this study itself looks at the fatalities per mile of interstates within the United States to grade and rank them based on how dangerous they are. And it gives some really interesting findings. And there's some really particular hotspots when you rank the roads in that way that are worth looking at in more detail.
And yes. How did you collect this data? Is this data that's reported from each state's DOT, federal DOT data? How did you collect this?
It's publicly available federal data that we have then pulled in other data sources around interstates and interstate length to enable us to calculate this index that shows us how deadly these roads are.
And so not only do you have the data for particular states, but also nationally, and with that data, are you able to tell your clients, hey, look, you know, you would probably be better served if you avoided this particular interstate in this particular state, because the accident rate is huge here.
Yeah, I mean, potentially that's something that you could push into the technology, and the broader sort of thinking around technology and IoT and transportation is growing all the time. And there's things that we can even do with weather fronts. So when weather fronts are coming in, we can actually change or tell drivers to change course to avoid weather fronts for safety reasons and productivity reasons. So there's a whole range of different ways that we can help drivers out on the road stay safe, return home safely to their families, and also help businesses stay productive.
Well, there's a show that comes out of Canada called something along
Rescue 401. For
Rescue 401.
Yeah, exactly.
And there's a stretch of roadway up there on the 401 in British Columbia, and I'm going, man, I don't ever want to be on that thing, especially in the wintertime.
Well, I think we may have that stretch in Houston, because from what I understand, one of his roads that's most deadliest is here in Texas.
Yeah, so let's talk about that. And I believe that road that Conrad's referring to is Interstate 45.
It is, yeah, Interstate 45. Well, Texas is actually quite interesting. It's actually the state with the most roads within the top 25 of the most dangerous in the United States. Eight of the top 25 are actually based within Texas. And the I-45 really stands out. And in our index, it has a 0.913 fatalities per mile over the time period of 2016 to 2019 that has it in position number two. So it is actually a particularly dangerous interstate. And the most dangerous place in there is in Houston, Texas.
Well, we're trying hard to get to number one.
Yeah, we got to beat them.
You've got to get past the I-4, so there's a little bit of way to go there. They're definitely out on their own by quite some way down in Florida.
Yeah, I-4 is between Tampa and Orlando.
Yeah.
Brutal.
It is.
Well, I will say this, and I said this earlier on in our three-hour show here, that I made a little road trip a couple of weeks ago from Houston to Mobile, Alabama, and it's about a 500-mile trip. Did it on I-10, and we headed from Houston to Mobile eastbound, and 500 miles, and I'll tell you what, I did not realize how much the traffic pattern has changed in the past 10 years on I-10, but it is brutal, and you better be on your toes because you could easily wind up an accident if you're really not focused on driving but on the cell phone or, trying to calm the kids down in the back seat. You really need to pay attention.
Yeah, and most of my driving experience in the U.S. has been in California, and obviously experience
in
the I-5 that ranks it. Well, I haven't had an invite yet, unfortunately. But it's on the I-5, and, you know, some of the roads on here are significantly more dangerous than that. So, yeah, it's definitely a case of being vigilant on these roads whilst driving and avoiding distractions key.
Well, let's extrapolate this a little bit and go, okay, Ben, so Teletrac Nav Man, I pay for your services, and I run a route several times a day between Houston and Dallas on I-45. What are you going to tell me now that you know that this is one of the most dangerous roads, not only in America, but also in Texas?
And the first thing that I would talk about is looking at how they're behaving and how they're driving. So the technology that we offer enables you to understand how a driver's driving. Are they speeding? Are they doing aggressive event activities such as aggressive acceleration, harsh braking? But with some of the latest technology, especially around cameras, it also enables you to understand whether they're distracted behind the wheel. Are they on the phone? Are they eating? Are they even fatigued by looking at yawning? I mean, you even can detect forward-facing, whether they're tailgating and following too far in front. So my main tip would be drive with care, and we try and support them through gathering information about how they're driving and put in place coaching to help train them to be safe along that dangerous stretch.
Well, you know, it used to be that I don't know whether it is anymore, but truck speed limits usually were about 10 miles an hour slower.
Yep.
Than a passenger car speed limits. But what they found was that it was more of a hindrance and created more accidents to have a 10-mile-an-hour an overtake speed. And so, you know, if the truck is doing 10 miles an hour underneath the speed limit, that alone can cause accidents. Well, I don't know how it is over there in England, but I can tell you here, if you're not doing 10 miles an hour over the speed limit, you're going to get run over.
You're in the way.
And so when you're dealing with 18-wheelers and you're, you know, advising them, do you advise them to run the speed limit or do you say keep up with the traffic pace?
I mean, it's a difficult one to say. I mean, you never want to encourage someone to break the laws, but from a safe perspective, I think the pace of traffic is also always important. So, yeah, it's a very difficult one to say. And on the question of what it's like over here, yeah, it's exactly the same. If you're not 10 miles an hour over, you're causing a problem on the roads. But yeah, it's a very difficult one to answer.
You can't really tell them to speed.
Right.
My question to that point, the speed limits. There's so many different speed limits here in Texas. You go to West Texas and 85 miles an hour is a posted speed limit.
I-45 is 75.
Exactly. When you get out of a certain demographic of people.
When you get north of Conroe all the way to
the population lessens and the speed limit goes up. So does that play into the analysis that you have?
No, you don't have anything that sort of factors in different speed limits. But I think it's a really interesting point because speed and traffic density obviously are factors that come into how dangerous places are and likelihood for accidents. And speeding is speeding and distracted driving are the number one causes for accidents in the United States. So, you know, staying to the speed limit and doing what we can there is important. But, you know, I agree with the comment there that it needs to be a collective view on not speeding. One person not speeding and everyone else speeding does become equally dangerous.
So you talked about gathering this data. Do you put a piece of hardware in these fleets that you service and to gather the vehicle driver information, the vehicle action information, or are you going off of cell phone, GPS stuff? How do you guys gather that data out of the fleets that you service?
Yeah, there's a very wide range of methods of gathering the data. The principal way that we use is to have a device that would be installed in the vehicle, and it would be connected to gather the ignition cycles, it would gather engine diagnostic data, it would gather gyro data to enable us to understand harsh events and activities. Then all of those events, activities, GPS data are transmitted it back into the software platform.
So you're actually plugging into the serial data of the computers of the vehicle.
Correct, yeah. Okay. And along with that, you also get engine diagnostics that enable you to understand things around maintenance requirements, events, alerts that have happened in the vehicle. And one of the other things that we do outside of safety is around maintenance planning and scheduling, and gathering that information and having it available in a head office can really support those activities as well.
So is this data, that this vehicle data, is this live fed to you, or when the truck comes back in for maintenance, it's downloaded?
It's in real time. So there's in the device in the vehicle as a SIM, and the data is transmitted in real time. So in the technology, you can actually have it. There's a feature called drone view. You can actually see a vehicle traveling along if you so wish. You can get events at the minute someone crossed the specific borderline and things like that. So yeah, it's real time data that's transmitted back.
So you could call into the truck and say, hey, slow down.
You could, but the technology is sort of advanced enough to do that for you. It could normally detect that, and it would automatically then do an audible alert to the driver.
Decrease the speed.
Yeah.
Exactly.
But I could also see if the vehicle got off track. You know, if somebody said, hey, this vehicle didn't show up an hour ago like it was supposed to, where is it?
Like the ambulance last night.
Yeah, or the other night.
Exactly. You can see the routes where drivers are. If you've got a delivery to make and it was supposed to be there at 10 a.m., you can trigger an event to say, has it been delivered yet? Yes.
Breakdown.
Or no, check, and then find where the vehicle is and all that type of stuff.
So we're looking at a map, basically, of Southeast United States, and we can see all of the yellow, orange, dark orange, and of Texas. And the only real red you have says Houston I-45. Is there a segment of Houston I-45 between mile marker X and mile marker X that drove that data, or is it just I-45 in Houston?
It's I-45 is the, as I said, the second most dangerous interstate. And Houston is the city along that interstate that has the most fatal accidents.
So in between.
So.
Go ahead. I'm sorry.
Oh, go ahead.
Well, I mean, basically, some of the stuff I read, it was measuring between Conroe and Galveston, which literally is Houston.
And that can be a 3-hour drive in some instances.
I don't see any green on this map.
No.
Well, this is just looking at the 25 worst. So I don't know if green, any of them are quite warrant being green, unfortunately.
Well, I mean, that's the way it is. You know, we've had a tremendous influx in population in the state of Texas here in the past 3, 4, 5 years. And so
from multiple locations.
And from what, you know, we see, you know, there is no additional lanes being added to I-45 that I am aware of anywhere in the Houston area. So you get all of these cars running down the freeway at 60, 70 miles an hour, all packed up on 3 or 4 lanes going into town.
And somebody comes to a stop because they want to make a right, but they're in the left-hand lane, and everything jams up behind them except for, you know, Tony, who's looking at his phone, who smashes into the back of Mary, and all hell breaks loose.
Yeah, I think it's a really good point around population and traffic density and road infrastructures catching up. I think that could be a huge contributing factor.
Yeah. Well, is there a place where the public can go to Teletrac Navman and gather up some general information on this?
Yeah, so our website is teletracnavman.com, which is TeletracNavman.com. I know it's a little long, so I thought I'd spell it out. Or you could just Google Teletrac Navman. It might be easier. There's actually quite a lot of other resources similar to this that do other data analysis. One of the interesting things we did previously was around COVID and the impact that COVID had on driving behaviors with the roads being so quiet. And that's quite an interesting piece that showed significant rises in speeding, stop sign violations, and harsh acceleration. That was a different data set that we pulled from our software platform. But if people are interested, go and take a look. It makes for interesting reading.
Well, I'll tell you what, this has been a real education, and it's a real joy and pleasure to talk to you. And thank you so much for joining us on your day off.
Well, it's been a pleasure. Thank you for having me. Enjoy the rest of your day. Hey. And I'll.
Hey, Ben.
Go drink a pint for us, would you?
Yeah. Where did you say you were at?
I am just north of Birmingham right now. So okay. Right in the middle of the UK.
Okay, my uncle that I was telling you about before we started, he was in a town called Welwyn Garden City, 20 miles north of London.
Yeah. I know the place. Yeah, yeah. It's actually a beautiful little town, Welwyn City.
Is that near Piccadilly Square?
It's got a beautiful park.
Yeah, no.
A little bit away.
Well, I hope that you're a Beatles fan because we are, and we thank you again for joining us today.
I'm a Rolling Stones fan.
Petula Clark for me.
Ben, thanks again. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
Ben Williams, Teletrac Nav man. Great information.
I was going to say great information.
Yeah, awesome. Truly is. All right. Time now for This Week in Automotive History. And we always look forward to this. I hope that you've got something good. And I hope that all of your slides are in order today.
Don't blame it on Jeff.
We know that you're going to go to A and Q shows up.
I think we should be good.
All right.
So here we go. In 1904, Louis Rigoli, driving a 15-liter Gabon Burrell in Belgium.
Gabon, isn't that a monkey?
Yep. Gabron.
They're not legal in Maine.
Drove this vehicle to over 100 miles an hour.
Oh, my God.
Creating a land speed record in 1904. How scary had that been?
It's not legal in Maine.
In 1911, General Motors organized GMC Truck to handle the sales of GM's Rapide and Reliance products and then join them together for GMC Truck. And actually, back then in those days, some of those were actually chain-driven.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. GMC stands for God Made Chevrolet.
Okay. Thank you very much. Mm-hmm. Also in 1911, James Robertson of Toledo, Ohio, received a patent for the terminal clamp and he was working for Champion Spark Plug Company at the time.
Cool.
So that was Champion's first patent on the battery side of things. In 1917, Rapp Motor Work was renamed to Bavarian Motor Works. Rapp Motor Work was one of the first aircraft engine manufacturers in Germany. So in 1914, they were making the Red Baron's...
Rapp.
They call him the Rapper. But they were making the engine for the Red Baron.
And, is that Tupac or is that Jay-Z?
No, it's not Tupac. It's neither of them. A pack and a half. In 1925, Sir Malcolm Campbell did 150 miles an hour in his Sunbeam, a two-way average.
It's a steam?
No. Sunbeam. Sunbeam was the name of the car.
That's a scary
thing. And it was on
thing.
The sands in Wales. This wasn't like at Bonneville or something. This guy's doing 150 miles an hour. And
no helmet.
Well, this isn't a picture of the car at the time, but, you know, no seatbelt either.
Yeah.
No roll cage.
And he's in a suit.
No mask.
They always drove in suits.
No mask. In 1934, Harold Ames filed a patent application for his retractable headlights. The design would later become one of the defining details of Ames's most triumphant product, the Cord 810.
Beautiful.
Which the chief executive, Duesenberg, asked the Cord designer, Gordon Behring, to make a baby version of a Duesenberg, and that's where the Cord 810 came from.
Oh, I'll be darned.
Such a beautiful car.
Nice.
Got to remember, that was also a front-wheel drive, 8-cylinder supercharged engine with hideaway headlights. Very, very advanced for its time. And then in 1935, the first automatic parking meter, the Park-O-Meter, was invented by Carl McGee and was installed in Oklahoma City by the Dual Parking Meter Company.
And he was shot and killed about 2 weeks later.
Is that the first meter maid?
That's the first meter maid.
Okay.
Rita, the meter maid.
Rita.
Lovely Rita.
They gave 20-foot spaces that were painted on the pavement, and the parking meter accepted nickels for payments. And now they've gotten much more complicated. They do Apple Pay and all kinds of goofy stuff to get all your money.
Just don't pay.
And it's a whole lot more than a nickel.
Let them catch you.
And then in 1987, on the 40th anniversary of Ferrari, they released the F40 at the factory in Maranello.
Wow.
It had a 2.9-liter twin-turbo V8 under the hood, and it was Italy's first production sports car to top 200 miles an hour.
Very cool.
Capable of 0 to 60 in 3.5 seconds and could hold a top speed of 201 miles an hour. I believe there's two of those here in town, and one of them shows up to some of the coffee and cars events with some regularity. And that is this week in automotive history.
Very cool.
A couple of more automotive stories that I need to get in before we close out today. Volkswagen of America confirmed that it is going to drop the slow-selling U.S. Passat sedan after the 2022 model to boost plans to build electric vehicles at its Chattanooga assembly complex. Hmm. Tesla, Consumer Reports said Tuesday, that Tesla's full self-driving software lacks safeguards and raised concerns the system's use on public roads puts the public at risk, citing reports from drivers. The influential consumer publication cited videos posted on social media of drivers using it and raised concerns such as vehicles missing turns, scraping against bushes, and heading toward parked cars. In April, Consumer Reports said its engineers were able to defeat safeguards on Tesla's autopilot and get out of the driver's
so
seat.
So in that light, autonomous vehicle technology startup Argo AI and its backer and Ford plan to launch 1,000 self-driving autonomous Lyft ride-handling network vehicles and starting in Miami and Austin, Texas.
Huh.
Austin, perfect. That's perfect.
That's two Austin mentions today.
Tesla plans to open its network of superchargers to other electric vehicles later this year, according to Elon.
For a fee.
Of course. They are all for a fee. The electric car maker's fast charging network with over 25,000 superchargers globally has given it a competitive edge. They're already there. Mm-hmm. Just make a different kind of plugger and away you go. So I'm sure that everybody will be looking forward to that, including me, because I know I'll be getting more electrics in the near future.
And you just have and to figure out where they are.
And the $10 per charge for 80%.
The 4.2 smart car.
At EVgo. Mm-hmm. That's not cheap. But at least it gets me some.
Takes you longer to charge it up than you get when you go to the gas station.
Oh, Lord, dude. Yeah. Anywhere between 30 and 40 minutes.
Yeah, you just need to put 80%. It in a restaurant, and then you go into the restaurant
or,
and get your charge.
As a matter of fact, at First Colony Mall, if you park outside of Macy's down there, they've got free chargers.
Okay.
Why didn't I know that? Why didn't the car tell me there's a free charger over there?
That's by Grimaldi's, on the other side of Grimaldi's, yeah.
So you just need to go to Macy's all the time.
And then wait in line like everybody else. To get in line
hey,
to
order
get
a pie, drink
well, they have
wine.
Chargers out at Intercontinental Airport, too, at the park and ride.
It's hot the easy go.
We need
go.
To take a quick break here on the In Wheel Time Car Show.
Ready.
We'll be right back to close things out.
Whether you own a newer car or want to keep your older one humming along for a while longer, think of Bayway Chrysler Dodge Jeep Ram, Bayway Chevy, and Bayway Lincoln to keep things in tip-top shape. From oil changes to major repairs, you can depend on the highly skilled service pros at Bayway Chrysler Dodge Jeep Ram, Bayway Chevrolet, and Bayway Lincoln to perform fast, efficient service to keep your investment running strong. For all your service needs, remember Bayway. Schedule your next appointment online anytime. Bayway, keeping it original. Tailpipes and Tacos, Houston's premier monthly car cruise-in, returns Saturday, August 21st at two Loopy Tortilla Mexican restaurants in Katy and inside the Loop on the Southwest Freeway near Kirby. Tailpipes and Tacos is free and everyone is invited. You'll see collector cars, hot rods, customs, magnificent originals, and resto mods at two locations. Cars from all over Southeast Texas cruise in and show off in a friends and family event at the Loopy Tortilla Mexican restaurant on the Grand Parkway at Kingsland Boulevard, just south of I-10 and Katy, and inside the Loop on the Southwest Freeway near Kirby. Drag racer, car enthusiast, and Loopy founder Stan Holt brings you Houston's hottest cruise in. Tailpipes and Tacos at Loopy's, inside the Loop on the Southwest Freeway in Kirby, and in Katy on the Grand Parkway, just south of I-10, where you'll see the In Real Time Car Show. Get your ride ready and we'll see you at the Tailpipes and Tacos Saturday morning cruise-in at Loopy's in Katy and Kirby, August 21st, 8 to 11 a.m., weather permitting. You see all the new ceramic car wash cleaners on TV now, but John Gray at Gulf Coast Auto Shield has been using ceramic coatings on Houston's most expensive cars for years, and he'll tell you that nothing beats the real thing. Gulf Coast Auto Shield installs a coating over your paint that actually comes with a warranty. If you just picked up your Lambo, your Aston Martin, Porsche, Ferrari, any other exotic car, chances are your car will have company that have already found Gulf Coast Auto Shield. Now, you don't have to own an exotic. Maybe you got a truck, an SUV, or even an older vehicle that needs a little love. Well, let John Gray give it a look and give you an estimate on refurbishing that paint and making your vehicle look new again. How about getting a gift certificate for the wife's birthday or anniversary from Gulf Coast Auto Shield and tell her, honey, I know you love your car, so why don't we get it looking new again? It'll be the best gift ever, one that she'll never forget. Get hold of John Gray at gcautoshield.com or give him a call, 832-264-0670. Gulf Coast Auto Shield.
Well, that's a wrap for another episode of the In Wheel Time Car Show. When you're on Facebook, give us a like, if you will. Tell your friends about us. Share our junk. You'll get Conrad's Unicorn Hunting features along with all things automotive all week long. The In Wheel Time Car Show streams on Facebook, YouTube, Twitch, and on InWheelTime.com. Podcasts are available from your favorite podcast outlet. Special thanks to all of our guests today, which we had a great lineup. Thank you, Mr. Mars, for
good
that.
Stuff.
The In Wheel Time Chief Engineer is David Ainsley.
our marketing manager and video technical director, this guy here. We need more Jeff Zekin. For booking agent, podcast man, Mike Out of This World Mars, his royalty, King Conrad DeLong. I'm Don Armstrong. Hey, be sure and join us each and every Saturday for our three-hour live broadcast across a multitude of audio and video streaming platforms. And podcasts are available, as we said, at your favorite provider. Today's show was produced by the Houston Heat. You are on the Smoke and Mirrors Network. Have a great, safe weekend. And we'll see you back here next Saturday from 8 a.m. to 11 a.m. Take care.